quality means doing it right even when no one's looking. And this talk is about exactly that situation. No one was looking. And because no one was looking, we almost delivered 100 tons of stracciatella mousse. But who are we? We are Metro. And we're in more than 25 countries. And this picture is taken like 20 minutes ago, right outside here in Vienna. So we're here, we're everywhere. But it's not only about Metro. It's also about Metronom. And we claim that we're the biggest IT company that no one's ever heard of. But when I see the reaction that we got earlier today, yesterday, and even at the dinner before the event, I think that's no longer true and we need to change this. So Metronom is Metro's exclusive IT company. We are developing everything that runs the business of Metro. And this is Toby. Toby works at the very core of the application. And this is me. I'm a part of our API team, taking care of all the over 1,000 microservices and exposing them to all the other teams so we can work together. But what we do for Metro, Toby, what do we do for Metro?
When we take a look at the order that the customer is placing, we need, in the beginning, a very sad customer because there's no order yet. If the customer has a very big craving for, stracciatella mousse, he just visits our web shop, which is done by us, and he places an order. That order then hits my team, that's the order management team, somehow the heart of the huge application chain we have, and we gather some article data, price data, customer data, everything you need to make the order complete. After that, an employee in the store has a look at that order, if maybe everything is in stock, if there are some problems with the order, some items are not available, maybe there are some restrictions in that country, maybe there's alcohol involved and you have to confirm that the actual customer is allowed to get that stuff, everything that's connected to that. Then we have huge warehouse all over in the countries. In Germany, I think there are 6 big warehouses. In Austria, I can look it up afterwards. And in that warehouses, we have nice colleagues of the pick and pack team. They really fetch the stuff, collect everything, and put that on the trucks. And then we have the trucks driver out there, like the nice picture Björn already presented, that will deliver the goods to the customer. And then, of course, we have happy customers because they receive the goods. But why did it actually happen that we almost delivered exactly 99,999 packages, more or less 100,000 packages, of the Dr. Oetker Stracciatella mousse, 1 kilo instant powder each, which has 60 portions. To make it a little bit more clear how much that is, we can use the help of the fire brigade. Because if we mix it up with 3.5 liter milk per unit, we would have 450 cubic meters of a mixture, and then we use the fire brigade to foam it up, 1 part of the mix, 4 parts of air, we would have 1,800 cubic meters. That is just the number, or more direct, 6 million portions with 10 bar by the fire brigade in 15 hours nonstop.
And we have lunch, no dinner.
Or you all know the Olympic swimming pools, 50 meters times 25 meters. It would be some more or less 1.44 meters. And we did not try to swim in yet, but it would be a very nice experiment afterwards. How did it actually happen that not only the system had a look and everything went very smooth, also there were 2 employees involved. The one who has seen the order and said, yeah, we are not in stock, but hey, we are Metro, we can do it. It's not so much. And the other one, yeah, that is not so much. Just 100,000 units of Stracciatella mousse. We have the big 40-tonner trucks out there. We can do it, no worries. How did it actually happen that 2 people said, yeah, this is fine? Because for us at Metro, it was not a bug, it's a feature. And Björn why was it actually a feature?
So to understand why this is a feature, not a bug, let's take a step back and look at our daily business. I guess most of you are actually staying in a hotel. Most of you have a minibar. And in most of these minibars, there will be nuts or there will be cookies on your pillow or like a little bar of chocolate. And hotels are one of our main customers. So we deliver to the customer whatever they need, cookies. And a hotel does not order like 5 cookies, not 50, also not 500. Because if you look at how many people are around here, we need more than this amount of cookies. So having a large amount to deliver is usual to us. 100,000 cookies? You might see that, yes. For a big event like this, sure. And, well, 99,999 units of stracciatella mousse, it is a lot, but it's not a number we don't see. What happened in this case, and what we see here is our actual system, is that if we have an order that's too big to actually fulfill, we get a notification. We get a warning. So we have an article that has an issue. And the employee also gets a notification what is the kind of the issue. So in this case, we did not have 99,999 units of stracciatella mousse in stock. Not a big problem. We have this from time to time. So a customer orders something. We don't have all the units he ordered, but we still start fulfilling the order. Because if you order for your restaurant and you need your steak, you get steak. You might not get all 200, but maybe 160. That means you can serve 160 portions. And then you can discuss with us, hey, don't deliver the 40 units I'm missing on the next day. Just leave them out, because if we don't sell them, that's overstock. So we're used to adjusting this. So the employee usually clarifies or checks what's the amount, should we go ahead, and resolves it. So he clicks the icon that you saw here and approves the order. Now the order, according to stock, can go and be delivered. Still, in this case, that was wrong. It was 170 cubic meters of mousse. It was 100 tons. And if you look at the value, 1.3 million in mousse, that's a lot. So this was not right. We would have enjoyed this order. It would be a huge benefit for our profit this year. But the customer would have not enjoyed it. So how can we detect this? We need to know what's going on in our system. As I said, quality is doing it right even when no one's looking. In this case, somebody oversaw this. But what if this even goes through because we can deliver? We need to see this. We need to be aware of this. So we log extensively. We need to know what's going on into our system. And then we need to make sense of it. Toby, do we make sense of it?
If we only log to have logs, we would just have a pile of logs and we cannot really do some stuff with it. Logs should tell you a story, a nice story you can read something in. A log is taken for a specific event in your system. So there should be a message in it you can deal with. And to have really useful logs, there are in total 4 different questions you can answer. The first one is, when did it appear? Normally, you use a Unix timestamp for that, because you can just simply store it in your database, read it on every system, and it's easy to handle. Second one, what happened? Not only, yeah, success, because, yeah, everything is fine, everything's fine, but what really happened there? Third one, where did it happen? If you have a huge system, like our core system with more than 200 microservices and there's somewhere, yeah, order is fulfilled, you're somehow happy, but you don't know where it just happened. And the fourth one, why did you log it? Is there maybe an error? Do you want to append a stack trace? Maybe some malicious behavior? There are reasons why you have that log. A bad example is only the Unix timestamp and its success, because it's not really storytelling if you have somewhere in your log system success message. Much better would be, to answer all of the four questions. First, you have your Unix timestamps. Then you have here a technical user. If you want to log the user itself, please anonymize them, because data protection, stuff like that, is very important. Then you have the get endpoint, which was here hit by a technical user. You have the where, the checkout basket endpoint in the credit payments IO service, and the why. It could be some nested, nested object. And the best way, if you have a huge system, is to JSONify it and adding unique identifiers. If you also have Kafka or some message queue involved, your request is somehow hopping from time to time, uncontrolled through your system, but you really want to filter maybe in Kibana or wherever you store your logs for the journey of your request, and then you need a unique identifier for that. Then it's really easy to have the complete story of your request through the complete microservice ecosystem. And if you have logs, you maybe want to improve and want to have metrics, like a pilot in his cockpit. The metrics are there. Maybe he's not always looking, like Björn already stated, but from time to time he has a short glimpse, maybe on the oil pressure or on the speed. Every metric can be displayed in a different way. Maybe some charts, some gauges, some numbers, but every metric for itself is very important and very useful for the pilot. But beware, as some economist Gotthard already stated, that any observed statistical regularity will tend to collapse once pressure is placed upon it for control purposes. Don't have metrics only to have metrics because they are so nice and colorful and looks fancy in my 40-inch screen in the office. Each metric should be really important. And how we can have seen our Stracciatella moves up front is the example here of our metric we have in our office on a dashboard. We see here three different types. First, the confirmed order on the left side. When a customer sends us an order and he really confirms that he wants to have that stuff. Then, when the order is delivered, we have to invoice, unfortunately, the customer. Bad for him, good for us. And from time to time, if there's a huge delay because some stuff is not in stock, there's maybe a gap between the invoiced orders and the confirmed orders. You can see in the top left that we have a small, or that we have no orders between Saturday the 11th and Monday the 13th because there was a weekend. It's very important, if you have metrics in your office, know your data, know your pattern. Only then you can see malicious and abnormal behavior. But you can clearly see that there's a huge peak on Wednesday. It's an order with more than 2 million, and that was the Stracciatella order. And we really noticed there's some stuff happening that's not a bug, that's maybe a feature for us, but it's not fetching our data, not matching our data. And we had a look at it and found the famous Stracciatella order. And how we can come up to those metrics will be now shown by Björn.
So the biggest hurdle always with getting up metrics is not getting data, because your system mostly already has data. You're doing something, so you store something. And what I want to look at now is a little bit of techniques. So we're going to set up a Postgres database and a Grafana instance, so a data source and a tool to visualize our data and visualize some data. So we set up for failure because I'll be doing a live demo. So we try to get an idea, what information do we have, how can we display them, and actually how hard is it to take the information we already have and put them up somewhere and gain some value without gathering additional information. So let's try to get this off the ground. So what I prepared to get the Postgres database up and also the Grafana instance is a Docker Compose file. So we will be running this in a container to keep my system nice and clean. And the first thing I would like to do is to look into the Docker Compose file. So as you can see, this is very little of a file. I basically stated two services with the default image and some ports. So we have a Grafana with a stated image and a Postgres database. For the Postgres database, I also stated a user, a database, and a password. For you to make it easy to hack it, I used the password password. Don't do that. I already spun both instances up. So we can see, for instance, our Grafana log. So let's do a Docker PS to show the running processes. So we have two. Postgres is running and Grafana is running because I did not run into the failure that it tries to download a newer image. So let's see at our Grafana. So we can do a Docker log. Docker logs. Oh, sorry. Thank you. So with every service, we already get some input in terms of logs. We see what's happening, where is it happening. For instance, I already had a successful login. I can see the remote address that this instance is running on. So it already gives me some input into what happened during startup. And it will also give me some input during failure. Let's already take one information out of these logs, because we will need this later for Grafana. Since both services are running in the same network, we want to have them connected to each other. So let's already pick up the address, the 172.30.0.1, so we can later on connect with our Postgres database. A look that we want to have at our Postgres database now. So this is actually a running Postgres database, not yet with any table, but with a schema. And the first thing I would like to do is create a table with some sample data. So I already prepared this up front, so we have data that looks nice later on, and also the create statement. So we will create a very simple table. We will have an ID to uniquely identify our records. We will use the confirmed value and the invoiced value that Toby already introduced. Just as a reminder, the confirmed value is the value of an order that a customer confirmed. So the moment you say, like, hey, I want to buy, I want to check out this basket, this is your confirmed value. The invoiced value, for instance, if you go shop with Amazon, is usually the same. In a B2B setup, this can be different. As I already stated, there can be an order that's not completely in stock that would reduce the value. Or later on, the customer says, hey, I only ordered 100 units, but I actually need 120. I missed that because my usual order is smaller. So we can adjust. That's how we get these different values. And last but not least, a timestamp, because we want to know when this happened. So we take all of this, and we run this on our database. Cool. This was successful. So let's actually verify. Let's refresh the tables. And we can see, hey, cool, we have some remnant data. And let's go ahead and query something. So we just query everything. It's only about 100 entries. And we can now see, hey, our database serves our data. This is something you have set up in your production environment. So there is data. You just don't see it. It can all be fine, or it can all be broken. We don't know. So how can we know about whether it's fine or whether it's broken? We want to have a visualization like we saw earlier. And we can easily achieve this with Grafana. We spun up an instance. We have a default login. Who can guess the password? It's admin. So it asks us to change it, because this is the first time we're interacting with the data with Grafana. So admin is the default. You usually would want to change it. It's a demo, so let's try not to set up for more failure. So the first thing it shows us is the home dashboard, with the steps we need to take to get this running. We already checked installing Grafana, so good job. Next thing is to connect the data source. And that's why we set up Postgres. And that's why we copied the address. So we already get a proposal of a number of data sources that we can set up, also Postgres. Let's select that and fill out our information. That was well. So it was 172.30.01 and default port 5432. Our database name is Stracciatella. If we would have known that you like chocolate more, we would have named chocolate. We have our password. We ignore SSL. And we can save and set up. If we go back to our default dashboard, we now have a data source set up that we can query. So the next thing is we create a dashboard. And here, since we have a Postgres data source, we can simply add a query. We can do this by doing some German clicky bunty. So by just using the graphical user interface, trying to add everything here. Since this is we are developers, we can also do SQL. So let's do SQL. Again, I have my handy cheat sheet. And let's start with something simple. So let me get this over to have focus on it. So we have a select statement. And we need to query for two values for our x and y axis. So we take the time, and we take the confirmed value. And we name it confirmed, so our graph has a nice labeling. We select from our random data table, and we just make sure that we actually have a timestamp. So if we have an entry that doesn't have a timestamp, this would filter it. And since we want to have our data in an order fashion, we order by timestamp. Next, we can choose a visualization. We're currently looking at the last 6 hours. So that's why we see a single dot. We now have the options to use just lines or bars to see how this impacts our data. Let's just look at the last 30 days, because that's the time frame where I actually generated data. So we can already see that this looks quite similar to what Toby showed earlier. We have our weekdays. It slows down to the weekend, goes back up again, and continues like that. So this seems to be already like a fine presentation for this. So we're happy with that and go back to our dashboard. A little crooked here, but the information is the same. As of now, this tells us, hey, cool, we have some data, we have a form, and we can take this away. So we have already some insights into our data. Let's add a second panel. And for the second panel, let's add the invoice data. So the same query, just a different value. The same metrics, same time frame. So now we get some more insights. So with the invoice data, we suddenly see a spike. So this could be something not normal, especially if we put them side by side, which we can simply do by drag and drop. We see that usually they should quite align in the form. And this does not match up. But we can even get this in a better way. So we had a third panel. Same thing. And this time, we do a little bit more of grouping. So let me get the query first, and then let's go over it. So as our x and y axis, we again have the timestamp. In this case, Grafana allows us to group our data. So I grouped them for one day. And to also have our y-axis data grouped, I summarized them. So I summarized the confirmed value, and I summarized the invoiced value, and I subtract them from each other, which gives me an idea what's the difference between the actual invoiced and the confirmed order value. And after that, I still, with SQL, state the table, state that I filter the time, and the grouping. If we put this now on the dashboard, we see that this data no longer correlates. This can be an idea that something's wrong, or cannot be. So by just adding simple graphs for the data we had, we generate a lot of insights. And also, we did this in maybe 5 minutes. That was quite quick. Add another 2 minutes to actually download the images for your Docker container, and maybe 2 more images to add a little configuration to get this not running with local instances, but with a remote instance, and also to have some data persistency, because that's something that I completely ignored for my setup. But that's still like 10 minutes. If you have a complex setup where you maybe need some help from an administrator to allow you to access the database, half an hour, that's nothing. For the insights we just have with these 3 graphs, half an hour is nothing. So we saw that we can quick start this really fast, like in this case, 5 minutes. But how do we gain the most value from it? Like, maybe data are not that simple. Toby, is there a recipe?
Of course. If there's a recipe for Stratzer-Tenemus, there's also a recipe to have useful metrics. Who of you is already using metrics in your company for private usage? Please raise your hand. Who of you has some fancy monitor in their office? Not so many. And do you have an idea how to come to those metrics, or did you just set there on? Who of you has a recipe for doing metrics? Even less people. Here we have 9 steps to come to useful metrics very quick and very easy. The first one is, ask yourself, what are the customers of the metrics? Are there business people? Are there financial people? Are there engineers? What is the target group? Second step is the goal. What should the metric display? In our case, we had the confirmed, the invoiced, and the difference. Then the question to come to that goal. How can you achieve that goal with a simple question? And if you have a specific field of customers, please be aware of that they maybe have a different type of understanding for some definitions, for some keywords, base words. Each kind of people have a different vocabulary. The 5th step in the recipe is the function. You need some math in there, but don't overdo it, don't overcomplicate it. In our example, and Bjorn already showed it, we just had a simple sum value over all invoice and confirmed orders. And with that, we could see in a huge ecosystem with more than 200 microservices that there was some feature that was not really for the customer's luck. Then the criteria, if you have an order that high, you hit some upper boundary or lower boundary, what should happen? And which people should you report? Which people should always get a notification on Slack, on Teams, via SMS? Who do you want to involve every time there's some abnormal behavior in the system? Last but not least, if you collect the data, who is collecting the data? It should be part of the workflow itself and not extra work, because then metrics are no fun anymore. If one people collects the data, it should be always the same way. If 2 people collecting it, it's the same, and it should be very easy and objective. And very important, don't measure on people, only measure on the system. Don't use metrics as a stick like you did last week $5, or your amount of commits could be much higher. That's not good, that's not very nice.
Maybe to add on that, to this day, we still don't know who actually checked the sus error order. We know that some employee did it. We know the system it happened on, but we don't know which person it did. Because we don't log who, as an actual employee, interacts with the system.
That's right. And that's your recipe to get to the to get to very useful metrics. If you want to have a deeper look, originally it were 12 steps. There's a paper, and the slides will be online afterwards, and you can have a deep look in the paper by Linda Westphal. That's how you get to useful metrics to avoid Oida. I said put a moose picture in that, but not that big moose.
Oida, it's a moose.
It's a very big moose, but the wrong kind of moose.
I liked it.
It's fluffy, it's nice, but it's eatable, but we won't.
It's eatable.
And that's why how you come up or how you can get very nice metrics. After the talk, we have some colleagues at the doors who will give you one little pack of moves. And if you're then, we are Metro, so you're welcome. If you prepare that moves in at home, please be aware, even if you don't every time have a look at your metrics in your office, quality means doing everything is right, even when no one is looking. Just have a glimpse at your metrics at home, or in the dashboard, or at the office, to avoid that the customer will be unhappy afterwards. And please follow us on social media. We will answer all questions that cannot be handled in the last minutes there. And the slides are online. Feel free to visit the GitHub project.
All right. Thank you very much for sharing the story, and thank you very much for the knowledge. All right, we have some Slido questions, so let's look at them. I see you already fulfilled the highest request during this talk, because you definitely sparked a craving for stracciatella mousse. So that's maybe feedback for organizer, maybe to get a swimming pool next year.
So if you need moves for your pool, just ask us. It's fine. We can deliver.
On time.
On time.
And we know how much.
Great. So let's get to the questions. So burning question, what about GDPR? Do you remove, replace, or anonymize the data you log? You already kind of mentioned that you do.
Yep.
You want to answer?
I can. If there are some logs where a user could be mentioned, we just remove the person names out of it and just replace it with asterisks. So yeah, of course, we anonymize our logs everywhere. Mm-hmm.
Next question, how can there be a generated automated message out of this anomaly in the graph?
So that's something I did not show with Grafana. And this is true for Grafana and most of the other tools that you can use to get up your charts. If you actually go down in the section where we configured how the graph is displayed, there's also a section for alerting. And you can alert to various channels. You can alert to Slack. You can alert to Teams, to email. You can display alerts within Grafana yourself, or even send text messages. So if you set that up and you declare your boundaries, like when do you actually want to be notified, you will get a notification just from the system, and it will make sure that it reaches you.
All right, so question about Postgres database. Is there any special reason why you are using it?
So in this case, for me, Postgres was very easy to set up. We are also using Postgres as a database within our company. A lot of teams use it. It integrates very nice with Spring Boot microservices. Other databases we use are, for instance, Cassandra. And it's way harder to just do a short demo with Cassandra. So that's why I choose a relational database and Postgres in this case.
All right, so we have a person with the name I want Stracciatella now asking, what kind of software do you use for measuring the KPIs?
Do you know the name?
I don't know the name, but we can look it afterwards. We'll be here around in the coffee area, and we can have a look.
All right, next question. Do you pass UID from system to system as a part of your messaging, or are they different in each microservice?
We are passing that around. When we are using Kafka, we have one weather word field for the UID. If we won't do it, there would be no need for a UID because then it would change every time. So yeah, we pass it around.
So maybe also to understand, we have more than 1,000 microservices running. And depending on whether which context you are in, a request might pass 10, 20 services. So if we would generate a new ID in every service, we would lose our order quite quick. So to make sure that we actually can follow the same order throughout multiple systems, order management, payments, pick and pack, you name it, they all get the same ID, so we can actually track throughout the services. There is some difference. We try to eliminate that. But a service is free to rename this field. So there might be some services that call it just UID. There's tracking ID. There's actually a standard how you should call these headers. It's currently not on the top of my head. So we try to minimize the difference here, but there we have difference. But it's the same ID.
All right. You talked about the problematic order. And there's probably a question to elaborate more on what was the problem with the order at the end.
We do not really know what was the problem. We might guess that it was copy-paste by the customer because the store itself afterwards called the customer, asked, do you really want that amount of mousse? And they solved it by their own. We just guess it was copy-paste. It could not be a typo where it just replaced a dot with a comma because you won't order 99,999 units of stracciatella. We don't know from a technical perspective.
Take a spoon out of it.
Yeah.
Probably a user error at the end.
Yep. In the end, we strongly assume user error.
All right. All right, moving on to the next question. How would you handle an employee with malicious intent if you don't lock their activities?
What would be some kind of malicious intent? So this is a very broad question. Maybe the person who asked it can get to us later so we can know a little more about it. Because in general, we trust our colleagues. So we assume that they do not have a malicious intent. And we do not want to do surveillance on our colleagues. So that's why we anonymize, not only because of GDPR, but we trust them. We know that we don't want to do surveillance on our colleagues. So feel free to approach us after the talk. We will be in front of this hall. And maybe we can discuss this.
Just as a side note, in the store itself, where the order shipped, different employees have different roles and different rights. And only a small group of people really can say, yeah, I want to ship 100 tons of stracciatella. And then the store manager is in charge to keep an eye on his employees. And it is a very small group, and they handle the issue. It's not, from our technical perspective, then an issue.
All right. Thank you for the answer. So next question is, does having Grafana up have any performance impact on the database?
So the clear answer is yes, but it's neglect. You can ignore it. You have a new software reading from your database, and that impacts the performance of the database. Usually, the impact is that small that you can just ignore it. If you want to be 100% safe, if you have like a really critical system, like controlling a rocket, you might think about something actually like copying data from the database to another source, having some master-slave approach maybe even, and then reading from a different database than you're actually operating on to minimize the impact or even remove it completely. But in our scenario, the impact is that small that we can just ignore it.
All right, so let's have one more question. That would be, why every metric is so important?
That's your question.
That's my question. I think the author means the confirmed invoice and the difference. Björn said that there is a difference sometimes between confirmed and invoiced because not everything that is confirmed can be invoiced afterwards. And if a customer has some special contract with the Metro AG, maybe the confirmed value, which is there in the web shop, is not the really invoice because the customer can have a discount. So we have a look. If there's a slight difference, then it's OK. But if there's a huge peak in the difference itself, we have a look. Even if there's an error on our side where we have a too huge invoice, it's very important. And the confirmed, why it's important, you have seen that peak that there can happen in Stracciatella bug.
All right, thank you for the answers. We have a couple of questions that have one upvote. I'm sure we can use that time for the people to meet you personally and talk to you. So thank you again, Björn and Tobias. This was an amazing talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you.